I'll be talking about perinatal mental health, the servicetal reformats, and the future horizons, in which I'll be talking about social contributors to perinatal mental health burden, pathways of care, existing public health approaches, service delivery formats in developed and developing countries, and what are the future horizons ahead. Talking about the social contributors to PMH burden, there are four major factors which are major contributors to the perinatal mental health burden. That is, first is isolation. Second is changes in the social media. Third is insecure employment, especially among young pregnancies. And the fourth is fast pace of modern life. Now, isolation is a kind of a subjective term, maybe from the family, maybe from the, you know, in case of single mothers, the isolation is more prominent. Which has been noted in the study, which is quoted by Howard and Kallivayalil. It was a review of progress and challenges, and it was published in World Psychiatry. The second in changes in social media, which I believe Dr. Vikas Menon also talked about, how the social media perception is different among different age groups. That is something which I know, and the body aesthetic, which Dr. Takoua talked about. So the changes in social media often influence the PMH burden. Insecure employment goes without saying, especially in case of young pregnancies, and the fast pace of modern life is also a major social contributor. We talk about why are different pathways of care required for PMH. Now, as Dr. Lamia talked about, why integration is required of the perinatal mental health in the service delivery formats, which are for general healthcare delivery services. Now, why pathways of care are important for perinatal mental health? First of all, it's a specialized science. It is not something that is coming across in a general care setting. It is a very special age group. There are two different age groups which are involved. First of all, is the child and the mother. Again, the child has different needs, the mother has different needs. In addition to that, when you add to that the dynamics of added psychiatric disorders also, it complicates the picture even more. And as we mentioned about, as it was mentioned the previous by my colleagues, the amount of the magnitude of psychiatric conditions in case of perinatal period is quite a lot, which you know, kind of implicates it in a more difficult way to provide the pathway of care. Multiple phenotypes within a single diagnostic construct. Now, when we talk about postpartum depression, there are multiple phenotypes with a single construct, that is a postpartum depression, which might need very individualized, need-based kind of service delivery. Third, we talk about multiple stakeholders. Needless to say, a lot of multiple disciplines are involved, multiple stakeholders are involved in the delivery of care. Precision science. Now, here I would want to say that perinatal mental health is not just something which is coming up as a general adult problem. No, it's a precision science. That means that individual needs are different, individual way of diagnosing is different. So again, it is also another reason why pathways of care are different for PMH is that increasing population burden with rapid development. Now, in India, the story has been somewhat lesser developed. In India, we do not really have it like a magnitude of a public health burden. The perception is different, although definitely the social perception says that it is improving, and we are getting more and more aware of the magnitude of the population burden, and we are talking about the intergenerational transmission of trauma and intergenerational transmission of impaired attachment patterns, and that can give rise to more and more clinical picture which is suggestive of neurodevelopmental disorders per se. And we need to be very vigilant about the long-term sequelae of burden. As I mentioned, the next point, we need to be very vigilant about long-term sequelae of the burden throughout the developmental lifespan of the critical perinatal period. And therefore, it requires very insightful policy-making decisions. Now, we'll go through existing public health approaches for perinatal mental health. Now, WHO and UNFPA, they have something called as Thinking Healthy Program. Now, Thinking Healthy Program was something which was started in rural Pakistan, and it was started and developed in Pakistan, which was later adopted by the WHO in the public health approach as a public health approach. And the THPP is a peer delivered program. And there was one other thing which was conducted as a clinical trial. And that was a cluster trial from Rawalpindi and another individual randomized trial in Goa. India, the place where I come from in India. So it was a peer delivered program, and this was something which you know, took a lot of population, took a big amount of population, but at the same time, one of the outcome of the study was that what they said is they could generalize this in a bigger way once they have, you know, the population could be, you know, different, and that could be the results of that could be generalized in a big way. One of the major limitations of this particular program, this particular thing, was that did not use any diagnostic interviews for the same, and that they mentioned as one of the limitations for the study. Now, this was quite a good one, and this was under SHARE networks. SHARE stands for South Asian Hub for Advocacy Research and Education for Mental Health. So that was one of the quite a notable one. It was under the chair of Professor Vikram Patel in Goa. So next we talk about National Institute for Healthcare Excellence Pathway, in which this is again another important thing, person-centered integrated approach. Now, as I mentioned about needs are different, the pathways of care are different, and that is why the approach needs to be very much person-centered and integrated across both the populations, the mother and the child. The third model, the third public health approach, which exists here, which we'll talk about here, is in from Northern Islands, which was step care model. Dr. Lamia talked about the step care approach, and this is something that was, you know, it was put into inception in Northern Ireland, and then thereafter the regional perinatal mental health care pathway was developed. The fourth I want to talk about is the Royal College of Psychiatrists has a perinatal specialist community mental health network, and that is something, again, see, CMHT is something which is quite a specialized team which talks just about the specialized perinatal mental health issues. They're specialists in that, and the ASI-Psych quality network for PMHS and mother baby units are also proposed under the same care, under the same collaborative public health approaches. And the last one I want to talk about is in Scotland, where the maternal and neonatal care plan. So when we talk about the public health approaches, what is the main outcome that is designed for this public health approaches is to decrease the mortality, morbidity, and the long-term developmental consequences in the child of the critical neonatal period, of the critical perinatal period, which is quite important. Next, we talk about service delivery formats and legislation in the developed countries. Now, service delivery formats and legislations are often dictated by prevalent mental health policies and legislature, which provide a framework for service provisions. However, it goes beyond that. Most of the service provisions is often determined by availability funding, as was mentioned by... As was mentioned by the Professor Menon. And by the availability of funding and manpower, which is often the most important aspect. Now, in UK, there is something called as NHS has managed clinical networks. In RCPSych's quality of care network is to ensure uniform mother and baby unit standards. And the NHS has a long-term plan, which is basically to improve the outcomes from the provision of services, that is increased funding for community-based mental health care, specialist inpatient care for mothers and babies, and increase of service provision to 2 years postnatal. In the US, in the developed country again, in US we talked about legal framework and initiatives. Now, there has been a lot of hue and cry about Black mother's death currently coming up in a big way, and on LinkedIn it is quite a fire. Now, when we talk about that, it goes much beyond. This is something that we see in the news, which is coming up in a subtle way. But we need to know the legal framework and initiatives, which is about Patient Protection and Affordable Act, which is a mandate for insurance companies to cover screening for postpartum depression. Second is the Black Maternal Health Omnibus Act of 2021, which is talking about how to alleviate the burden from Black mothers' substance use disorders, now which contributes in a major way to the postpartum depression. And the U.S. Health and Human Services call to action to improve maternal health is worth mentioning here. Now, also, first mother and baby unit in U.S. was established in Rhode Island, which is in 2000s. Now, let's talk about the service delivery in developing countries. Why it is a point of concern more for the developing countries? Because it's not just about the disease. The social, psychosocial factors also often play a very important role. Now, poverty is very much common. Racism, yes. Food insecurity is something which is more of a problem in case of developing countries. Lack of equitable access, domestic violence, child marriages, and disparities in reproductive health rights of women. Quite important factors. And poor social networks and marginalization of women or gender disadvantage is something which is quite coming up. Now, what are the social degree formats in developing countries? As Dr. Menon also described about Amma Manasu, India has a small state called Kerala. The Kerala initiative is something that they started calling at first. Amma Manasu is like a referral pathway, which is like a maternal mental health program, referral pathway through the district mental health program. And MCTS is mother child tracking system. So as to see for the well-being, how is the mother, how is the child doing? It is called as Amma Manasu. And then we talk about legal reform mandating the change in service delivery formats. Now, MSA 2017, quite an important legislation which we have seen coming up in the recent years. I have even published a research paper with the same with respect to the MSA 2017, which is to elicit for the experiences of the psychiatrist in implementation of the act, and what is the experiences in transition of this particular act. What are the experiences of the psychiatrist in transitioning from the older act to the new act, which is like Mental Health Care Act? It mandates mother-infant joint care. Now, this is more of a rights-based approach which was advocated after UNCRPD conventions. And this is enforced in passed in 2017, enforced in May 2018 in Goa. So thus, mother-baby psychiatric units are being set up in different parts of country, most notable in Nashik, Gujarat. Nashik is a place in Maharashtra, and Gujarat is a place is a state in the west of India. Mother and baby psychiatric units. Now, this is again quite an important aspect of this is multidisciplinary team. Multidisciplinary team is also always there on duty in case of psychiatrists, which consists of psychiatrists, psychiatric social workers, psychologists, and lactation experts and pediatric support professionals. Now, there is something called as first MB, which is a procedure that is followed, on which we can decide whether the person needs admission or not, the unit, the mother baby unit needs admission or not. There's a formal initial risk assessment for mothers and babies, first MB. In Africa, what they do is, in Uganda, there is a health infrastructure which is divided into HC1, HC2, HC3, and HC4. The volunteers form the village health teams, and there is a public hospital one in each district, and there is a referral pathway to the district hospital from the health infrastructure level 1, HC1. In Nigeria, these facilities are managed by experienced midwife nurses and senior community health officers or senior community health extension workers. Some perils are often impacting the service delivery, such as staff shortages, irregular payment, lack of regular ongoing in-service trainings, and for healthcare professionals on perinatal depression. However, no specific chronic care arrangement was identified for perinatal depression. This is according to a review article and about the quality of perinatal depression care in primary setting in Nigeria, which was an article published in 2018. Other suggested healthcare policies aimed at recruiting and retaining healthcare professionals. We come to the last few slides. What are the future horizons? First and foremost, as we know from the literature, there should be a focus on the training needs, focus on how to use the instruments, focus on how to go ahead with the implementation in real life situations. And as Dr. Lamia mentioned, a lot of different workshops are in the making. In 2025, early 2025 or so. We look forward to that. Second is provision of skill building initiatives in parents. Now, what I see in my general private practice is such that parents have some kind of problems handling with respect to the perinatal period, because it is a particularly stressful parents for the period for the parents, at the same time for the mother and the father, both, and the child too. So definitely skill building initiatives is something which can be looked out, and those initiatives, those workshops, the workshop should be focusing on skill building, developing evidence base for new treatment options, improvisation of innovative service delivery formats, and personalized approach towards perinatal mental health is warranted. First is about focus on training needs of professionals. Now, current resources are in European Institute for Perinatal Mental Health, who are pioneers in PMH training. Variety of trainings available based on neuroscience of PMH, epigenetics, perinatal psychology. NAMHANS India also has an online certificate course for perinatal mental health, and PMHT CIC UK, Perinatal Mental Health Team, delivers training of PMH, paternal mental health, and culture awareness training. Now, this is one of a kind thing wherein we are also talking about paternal mental health, which is not so much talked about in the scene of perinatal mental health per se. Skills building initiatives. Now, this is something called a sure start to UK, which is under 4 years. Now, this report card, there is a report card, there is a program, and then there is a report card in the end of it. It's aligned to 5 sure start policy outcomes for children and families, which include, first and foremost, improved language skills, improved access to services, early identification of developmental delay, enhanced parenting skills, and effectively integrated services. Now, I would like to talk about my clinical experience with one of the patients I'm seeing in Goa. Now, early identification of developmental delay is something that parents know per se, but they do not really know how to screen for maybe ADHD, what kind of an inattentive symptoms, what kind of hyperactivity symptoms, what are the sensory motor incoordination that they see in the patients. And I have a patient, this patient that I'm talking about is around 22 years old, and he had a comorbid ADHD as well as autism. Now, the funny thing is that he was shown to the primary health center, tertiary healthcare centers, even the private medical colleges or in the private medical centers. But there was no way that he was diagnosed with the comorbidity of ADHD. Although there were gross inattentive symptoms, it was just dismissed as a symptom of ASD. And when I had seen him over a good 2 years, about within the first year of assessment, I administered some tests on him. As per the clinical assessment also, looked like he had comorbid ADHD with autism. Now, ADHD, the hyperactivity has gone down, as in case of adult ADHD. He's now 22 years old. I started him on a conjoint of methylphenidate plus aripiprazole for the behavioral disturbances, but now aripiprazole is tapered off and weaned off. Now, he is having such a huge improvement in his functioning that earlier he was a person who would be sitting at home, would be so overwhelmed, would be having quite a lot of behavioral disturbances, difficult time for the parents. But now he is so much improved in his functioning so that he goes cycling and he cycles for about good 10 kilometers at a stretch. So that is something which the parents are really happy to see in him. This is something where comorbidity diagnosis comes in, and again, enhanced parenting skills is quite a lot of importance too. University of Bristol is also undertaking a study evaluating the physical feasibility of perinatal emotional skills for women with borderline personality disorders. Now, as I mentioned about borderline personality disorders coming up in the pregnancy, perinatal emotional skills are more and more important because there is an addition of a new member. And at the same time, the distress tolerance, the mindfulness, emotional regulation component is quite a lot of disturbance is seen. With related to the biology and the biological changes which are coming up in the pregnancy, parturition, postnatal care and everything. And interpersonal effectiveness is often getting hampered. Interpersonal effectiveness also implies and extends to the mother-child interaction, wherein the focus on parenting skills is of paramount importance. Lisbon University is conducting a program for perinatal mental health promotion and work-life balance, which is registered as a clinical trial. Now, interventions, what they are trying to impart to the population is coping skills, help seeking efficacy, work-life balance, biofeedback, and CBT-based psychoeducation sessions. Developing evidence base for new treatment options is one of the future directions we are looking at, in which I would like to mention about two things, University of Derby and NICHD US. They are using, University of Derby is doing this quite a wonderful thing wherein they are exploring the use of art psychotherapy within the PMH service. Quite an important thing, and it's more multidisciplinary than we can think of in the general setting. NICHD US is also evaluating a program called as Promoting First Relationships in the Spirit of Provision of Collaborative PMH Care and Parental Support. Basis of this theory is attachment theory. We mentioned about lack of unhealthy attachment will be giving rise to a lot of intergenerational transmission of trauma. And what NICHD US is trying to do is nip it in the bud. They are talking about attachment therapy. Each week has a theme for discussion, handouts, activity, and a time for joining. They check in with the parent, listen to the concerns in handling the child, and how to establish a positive supportive relationship between the mother and the child or the parent and the child. The provider videotapes a playtime between parent and child and alternates every other week with watching the video with the parent, reflecting about the needs of both parent and child. Now, this is somewhat analogically similar to parent-child interaction therapy in case of ADHD. And this is something which is like a instant feedback is also given to the patient, to the parent. And they have developed greater empathy and understanding of the child's needs and feelings. And this is very much quite so much important, most likely in the case of neurodevelopmental disorders. Improvisation of innovative service delivery formats, managed clinical networks. We mentioned earlier that they are not statutory bodies, but they are partnerships involving multiple disciplines and professions. A better term for a multidisciplinary team, I should say, and they can be used to share treatment cost and provision of a reliable network of professionals. Now, as I practice in India, I see this coming up in a big way, and this can make the whole of the whole lot of change, I should say, because there are centers coming up in talking about centers in Goa. There are centers coming up in Vasco, which is like an airport town, in which a lot of therapists are in one roof. And I talked with them just a little few months back. They mentioned that it is difficult for patients to come because of not so much developed public transport, because of which they believe in providing a multidisciplinary care under one roof. And that is something which is which should be the thing which we see in which we should be seeing in government public health hospitals. Yeah. Second, we talk about provision of community-based services. We talked about Homestart UK, which aims is decreasing loneliness, isolation, low self-esteem. It's a volunteer-based, just like the PhD. THPB. Okay. And then we talk about Moms in Mind, which is specialized support groups, and dad support groups are also present in UK. And there we talk about Homestart strategy first. And then that is a strategy from 2022 to 2027, in which the four pillars include growth, voice, inclusion, and impact. Lastly, we talk about integrated service formats. Increasing burden of non-communicable disorders with rising perinatal mental health disorders burden imposes greater challenges in treatment. That is why integrated service networks are quite important. Integrating link workers. Now, we talked about ASHA. ASHA is an accredited social health activities. Dr. Memon talked about it. They're also called as social prescribers because they can be trained easily and they can be trained to conduct need-based assessment. When you're having the population needs understood, it is very important and makes the policy planning process a little bit easier. When you know the needs, you can tailor the process according to the needs of the patient.
Can you check your time a bit?
Sure thing, sir. I'll just take another 2 minutes. We come to the last point, which is talking about personalized approach towards PMH, tiered approach towards perinatal mental health disorders. Even if the psychological therapy is administered, around 50% recover, while 2/3 show benefits. Further research directions, there's something called as PRIME, which Dr. Lamia talked about. And I believe most of the things are covered in the directions. And this is the last slide. We talk about future directions for research. What I believe personally is there has been minimal translational research with a focus on immune and genetic studies. What we need to look out for is descriptive discovery and delivery studies. And with that, there is a lot of developmental, there's a lot of scope for translational research in India and abroad. With that, I end my presentation and we are open for questions.
I think we won't have time for many questions, but one of the things is how much is these? So two very short questions, and if maybe others from the previous speakers can comment as well. First one is, what's the role of the father in all of this? You know, having three daughters myself, so what's the role of the fathers? And from my experience, it's can be very destructive and very positive. And how much do these programs focus on people with established mental health, or how much do they focus on people who have who might have undetected mental health problems? Is anybody?
Dr. Lamia can take it up.
Yeah, so thank you for these questions, Dr. Rainer. So maybe it didn't come out that clearly in my presentation, but those programs focuses as much on the undetected ones as the ones that having disorders. Of course, the ones that have a history of mental disorders might, let's say, might be the ones easier to...
Okay, and the question about the parental role, the father. Anyone to answer?
Sorry, can you hear me again? So I was saying that those problems as for both the one with undetected mental health disorder and the one that already are having mental health disorders, there is no distinction between them. The algorithm as well, they start from the screening, but also you can start from the point that we ask about the history, and then there is a history of mental health disorder, or they come already with a mental health disorder and then they go further. The treatment, of course, might be, I mean, the care, delivered care might be different. The one with already mental health disorder might need more, more holistic, I mean, more care, or more, they would need maybe more services. And for the caregiver role, the role of the caregiver is more important. The impact, it was shown also that the mental health of the fathers have now had a very important impact on the child. And I'm really, really sorry. Just like,
I have no idea.
So, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Excuse me, Lamia, if you want, just to add to what you say regarding the father, the problem, we include, we are trying to include more and more father in studies, but it's still really understudied. But there is a real correlation between all what we said about mother, also about father. And it seems that they have the same possibility of depression, anxiety, problem, mental health problem, and their mental health has a big impact because the mother needs the father. And we find that mother without a partner, or mother with a partner that isn't supporting them, have more struggles than mother with a partner who is supporting. So it's double. It's impacting directly the child and impacting the mother because they are not there, and indirectly the child. So maybe in the future we will have more father included, especially that the role of the father in this parenthood are changing also. We have more father implicated in the daily activity taking care of the child like moms than it was in the past. So we need to progress regarding this.
Okay, is there other questions?
I just want to ask one more question. This is a wonderful series of presentation on perinatal psychiatry. We all know that the perinatal mental health is also significantly influenced by the social support system. Now the family system is changing. Now we are having more nuclear families than joint families. The support system of the parents or the mother maternal support system is gradually becoming weaker. Now mother have to take care of the child, have to do the household responsibilities and job related responsibilities and deal with the mental health issues. So the number of mental health issues with perinatal mothers is increasing in India, particularly in the urban areas where the support system is quite weak and only husband or wife and there is a kid, small kid is there. So mother have to take care of because of the lack of support system. So what is the scenario in the other countries? I just want to have your feedback.
I can give from the Tunisian and the French experience. So the Tunisian experience, maybe it's more like, I don't know how is it in India, but we are dealing with the same thing. More mother, more family are nuclear. 20 years ago, it was more a large family with a large support. So it is more and more the role of kindergarten, and the struggle is more present, and there is less real lack of intervention from the government, but we are trying to improve. So there is more and more what we call PME, mother and infant defense support. It's a structure where there is a pediatrician, a gynecologist, or sage-femme, and a social worker. In France, there is more things that are being already done. For example, there is systematically intervention with the mother and the father after during after birth. So after birth, the mother will stay at hospital 3 days at minimum, where she will meet someone to help her how to breastfeed, someone to help how to take care of the child, and how to hold even the child, which seems very normal, but for mother, for the first time, they need this intervention. And also the father is implicated since the birth in this activity. At the 8 day after discharge from hospital, there is a midwife that come to the house systematically to see how the parents are adjusting the environment at home and what they could do more, what can be done more. And if she finds that parents are struggling, if she finds that there is a real medical problem, she will ask for a doctor consultation. And if she finds that it's more social, lack of economic resources or things, so she can call what they call also PME, where there is a pediatrician, a general physician, a social worker, a familial worker. They are person who intervene with family at home twice a week or three times a week, where they are only there to help family how to adjust to the new child. And there is also what we call mobile unit of psychiatric help, where there is psychologists, social worker also, and infirmière, how we say, nurse, who will go for more. It's an assistant for mother and father with psychiatric disorder or psychological struggle. And after the 8 day, there is also 50 days, 1 month, 2 months. And so until the 3 years of the child, there is a very presence of medical and psychological and social worker with the family. So it's that's what are trying to replace the system where there was only family who take care. So it's the state and the government who replace somehow this family.
Okay, I have to say thank you. And do you want to write just a couple of seconds of a last word? But I think this is a very important issue which really would need another independent meeting, but we don't have time. And I know Professor Rohit Kallivayalil is already waiting. Is there anything you want to finish this off, Rohit?
Nothing as such, Professor. This has been quite good, and it took quite a lot of effort, and it has been quite fruitful. And thank you for the opportunity. And good presentation by Dr. Lamia and Dr. Takoua.